I think about this time of the year, what comes to my mind is football. On Friday nights, we have high school football, and with high school football, there are winners and there are losers. On Saturdays, we have college football, and there are winners and there are losers. On Sunday and Monday night and Thursday night, there's pro football and there's winners and losers. And, of course, we know that goes on even into baseball season and basketball season. And I guess in soccer you can actually end the game 0-0, but I think they still figure out somebody won and somebody – I've never figured that one out, so we just won't go with soccer. But you get what I'm saying. When we play those games, and for it's more than just play for a lot of people, it's work. They're winners and losers. But then we take that and we apply it to all areas of life, and we seem to get to that place where we think that in everything we do, there has to be a winner and a loser. But I want us to see today that God's plan is a win-win plan. That there won't be winners and losers as God's people. There it is a win if we do it His way. So God wants it to always be a win-win for His people. So that's what we're going to look at today. We're going to be again, as I said, in the book of Malachi, which is the last book of the Old Testament. So if you need to get there, go to Matthew and back up. And you'll run into it real quick. There's probably in your Bible a blank page in between the two. That blank page represents 400 years of silence of God. And so as we look, we see and realize what's taking place here. God has done some incredible things for the children of Israel. We know He brought them out of captivity, and then He led them into the promised land. And we know from looking at the Bible stories and studying them that there was a cycle that took place. God blessed His people. His people followed Him. Then His people wandered away from Him, and God used different things to bring them back to Himself. And then they followed Him, and then the cycle goes on and on and on. Well, today we're going to see that taking place, and God actually uses the book of Malachi, and the key phrase is in chapter 3 that we're going to look at today, and that key phrase is, "Return to Me." God is always a God that wants to redeem, that wants to bring His people back to Himself. And so throughout the book of Malachi, the whole thing is return to Me. Now, when I say Malachi, my guess is if there's anybody that's sitting in the church today that has spent any time studying Scripture, any time hearing sermons, when you hear Malachi, you think of Malachi chapter 3 because somebody's going to talk about giving. And I'll be honest, I've been guilty of that myself. It seems like I've never really spent a lot of time in the book of Malachi, and that's my fault. Through this time of looking at 1 Timothy and then looking at Malachi for this sermon and doing some more studying, let me tell you, we are going to spend some time in Malachi beyond chapter 3, okay? Because God has some amazing things to warn us about in the book of Malachi. But this morning, we are going to look at Malachi chapter 3 and look at our possessions. Now again, when you hear these kinds of sermons, everyone's expecting to be beat up on. And it has been used that way too many times. But I think Pastor John Metter at First Baptist Church Euless, who helped me see a fresh and a positive approach to this. And so I hope you see that also as we look at these passages. So here's what I want us to do today. I want us to understand how God works in our lives, specifically in our finances, in our jobs, and in our material possessions. I want us to see today that, and I want us to have a spirit and leave here with a spirit of generosity that brings joy into our lives. Not something that we're being beat over the head with or being forced to do, but a generosity that brings joy to our lives. I want us to see God work in supernatural ways of provision. I want us to have faith that it takes to walk with God in our finances. Now, I can tell you that I don't believe there's anything that has bolstered my faith in God in all areas of my life like it is walking in faith and faith through faith in faithfulness to God in the area of giving. It seems like that has permeated all areas of my life once I got that. And so I hope you get to that place too, where you see this isn't the focus. The focus is the whole person. The focus is what God wants for us. And one of the ways that we gauge that is how we deal with our finances. I know for me, how I deal with my finances is a pretty accurate gauge of where I am in all the other areas of my life. I think that's why God talks about it so much, because that's the way it is for all of us. So we're going to look at these areas and hope these will be the outcomes as we look at Malachi chapter 3. Would you stand with me in the honor of God's word as we read, beginning with verse 7. Since the days of your fathers, you have turned from my statutes. You have not kept them. And then we see that key phrase, return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. Will you rob God? You are robbing me. You ask, how do we rob you? And then he answers, by not making the payments of 10% and the contributions, you are suffering under a curse, yet you, the whole nation, are still robbing me. Bring the full 10% into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house. Test me in this way, says the Lord of hosts. So if I will not open the floodgates of heaven and pour out a blessing for you without measure. I will rebuke the devourer for you, so that it will not ruin the produce of your ground, and your vine in your field will not be barren, says the Lord of hosts. Then all the nations will consider you fortunate, for you will be a delightful land, says the Lord of hosts. Lord God, we thank you for your word. Lord, I ask that this morning you teach us from this great truth of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now again, too often when we look at this text, we look at it from a very negative view and we get negative vibes. But God is saying, yes, there are negative consequences not being obedient. But as we read this, we see some great truths and some great encouraging facts of some things that God wants for you. Think about that. What does God want for you? And then in these verses, we see four things. God wants you, number one, to experience His presence. God wants you to experience His presence. In the very first verse, God says, and I will return to you. Can you imagine being without God? Now, we know that as believers, as children of God, when we come to God in faith and we accept Him and we receive salvation, that we have the indwelling Holy Spirit and God is with us. He goes with us everywhere. But there's a difference in the indwelling Holy Spirit of God and the manifest Spirit of God. It is that manifest Spirit of God that we're talking about. God being with us, us being in the presence of God. Do you realize that this idea of God's being present with His people begins in the book of Genesis? When you think about Adam and Eve in the garden, the Bible says in Genesis that He was walking with them in the cool of the day. They were literally in the presence of God. And then, of course, we know the story that where Eve is tempted and Adam and Eve sin and they partake of one of the two trees, of the fruit of those trees that God had told them not to, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And so they partake of that fruit. And we remember that in that they realize that they're naked, and in that they have that shame and that guilt. They literally hide themselves, try to hide themselves from God. And what does God do? He walks into the garden and He calls them. He calls them out. He wants them to be in his presence. They're hiding from him because of their shame and their guilt. And so God does, he offers the first sacrifice. He takes an animal, he kills that animal, and he clothes both of them to cover their guilt and their shame. Folks, we don't have time to do this, but that is a beautiful picture of what happens in Jesus Christ in the New Testament. Covering our guilt and our shame of sin. Then we look at Adam and Eve and we say, well, then he kicks them out of the garden. What a mean God. But what we forget is there are two trees that he told them that they weren't supposed to eat of, and the other one was the tree of life. And if he had left them in the garden based on their activity level, if they had eaten from the tree of life, they would have spent an eternity in their sin, dead in their sin. So what God did was, out of mercy for them, move them away from that tree so they wouldn't stay in that position. And then we have Christ coming on the scene that brings salvation. So in Genesis, there is that call, that desire of God for you, for them, and us them representing us to be in the presence of God. In the New Testament, in the first book, in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, God, or Jesus, reaches out and he says, come to me. Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Jesus wanting us to experience the presence of God. In the final book of the Bible, Revelation 22:17, it says, both the Spirit and the bride say, come. Anyone who hears should say, come. And the one who is thirsty should come. Whoever desires should take the living water as a gift. God calling you to his presence. Come. Return. He wants us to experience his presence. Now, I believe the Bible teaches, and what we teach is that once you're saved, you're always saved, so you can't lose your salvation. But let me tell you, I will admit that there have been times in my life that I've walked away from God. I've seen more important things than the church. And so I put it on the back burner and I went on with my life. And then there have been those areas of my life where I have walked away from God. And here's what I've come to understand. I hate not being in the presence of God. There is no place better to be than in the presence of God. And by that I mean, if you think you're in the worst place in your life and you're in the presence of God, you're better off than what you think might be the best place in your life and be there without God. God wants you to experience his presence. Secondly, God wants you to experience his balance. Verse 10 says, bring the full tenth into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house. You say, well, what do they need food in the house for? Food there represents the provisions for the ministers and for ministry. This is where the ministers receive their funds there to eat and live, and this is also what was being used to do ministry. And so he says, bring that tenth into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house. There's something about looking beyond yourself, something about giving to others, being generous, that brings balance and a healthy balance to our lives. In the Garden of Eden, it was leaving what was for God alone and enjoying all the rest. When Noah took all the animals onto the ark and that period of time of the flood, and then God's provision, and it was time now to come out of the ark, and Noah and his family and all those animals had been preserved and not killed. Do you know what the first thing he did? He came off that ark and he offered a sacrifice. And he literally sacrificed one of every animal on the ark. We think about that and we say, wait a minute, he was supposed to preserve the animals and now he's killing them. He offered them as sacrifice to the Lord. Literally, almost one seventh of the animals that were on the ark at the time, it's estimated, was used in that sacrifice. Giving back to God. Learning that balance that God wants us to have. when the people of Israel would go in and overpower a nation that God has told them to take over, and as they move through the promised land, we see time and time again, after they won the battle, one of the first things, if not the first thing they did, was to take the spoils of the battle and to give a tenth of it to God. Old Testament, and we see the principle in the New Testament. Here's what I want you to think about. People that only consider themselves and not others become selfish and prideful people. But through generous giving, we experience balance in our lives. And we see God do some incredible things. God wants us to live a life of balance, even in our finances. Thirdly, God wants you to experience His faithfulness. I think all of you will agree that God provides for our families. I mean, we can just look and see different ways, no matter where you are and what's going on in your life. And I truly believe, though, that it can be so much more than that. Malachi 3:10 says, "Bring the full tenth into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house." And then he says, "Test me in this way, says the Lord of hosts. See if I will not open the floodgates of heaven and pour out a blessing for you without measure." For some reason, we always stop at the first period there instead of seeing the whole thing. And we need to see this is what God wants for you. It's so much more than we think of as we pray. Thank you, Lord, for this food. Now lay me down to sleep. Get up in the morning. Thank you, Lord, that I lived through the night and I'm ready to go for the next day. And we just look at those basic things and that's what we're thanking God for. But God's doing so much more. And He wants there to be so much more. I love what John Medder said. He said, God wants us to see His direct provision unexplained by anything else. Unexplained by anything else. Not something I could have done on my own. Not something that I was smart enough to get done. But He wants us to see Him providing in such a way that it can't be explained any other way. Do you realize that in this passage, in this verse 10, is the only place in Scripture, the only instance in Scripture, the only circumstance that God tells us to test Him? He said, if you don't believe this is true, test me. I talked to a pastor the other day that said he just preached a sermon on it. And he said, look, if you will test God in this, if it doesn't work in a month, I'll have the secretary write you a check. Now, you need to put a whole lot of parameters on something like that. But listen, I have found in my own life that God will prove Himself faithful. There was that time, and many of you have heard this story, and I'm going to tell it again, but there was that time we were in seminary. Part of the reason for seminary is to keep us poor. And we were in seminary, and I was working two part-time jobs and going to school. Jerry was working a full-time job, and we were struggling to make ends meet. Two children in school and braces on both and all the stuff that goes along with that. We had to have two cars because Jerry went to work at one time and I went to work two jobs at different times and went to seminary. So there was just no way in Fort Worth that we could get by with one car. The transmission fell out of my car. Had a preacher friend who said he was a mechanic. Don't ever trust that. I lost that $400, $500. Because after he fixed it, a week later, it fell out. I mean, just quit. And so all I could do was take it to the transmission shop. And they said, it's going to be $975 for your transmission. They explained to me all the reasons that it was a special transmission. It's an old, man, it can't be. It's a Delta 88. Special? But yeah, it's special, $975. We put the thing in the shop. We went out of town that weekend in our minivan, and we owned one. And We went out of town. We came back, and it was Sunday afternoon. The car needed to be picked up Monday morning so we could do what we had to do. And so, now, guys, we were in seminary, so we were right where God wanted us to be. We were involved in a local church doing ministry. We were tithing, but here we are, need $975 and no clue where it's going to come from. Jerry went to the mailbox, and she opened an envelope. And as she opened that envelope, she read these words, "We don't know what your need is, but God told us to send you this $1,000. Guys, I still get emotional about that. Because here's the rest of it. This came from friends who were missionaries in Zimbabwe. Missionaries don't send you money. But they sent us $1,000, and it was sent 2 weeks before the transmission went out. Don't tell me God won't provide. He does provide. Just this summer, we were doing an in-gathering here at the church, and Jerry and I had talked about and prayed about what our part was supposed to be in that, and we came up with an amount, and we were prepared to do that. And then God began to tell me, you need to do more. And I'm saying, God, how can I do more? Where is it going to come from? And on the Friday, before the offering was taken on Sunday, a check came in the mail. Now, we expected that check. We had no idea how much it was going to be for. And we were told to expect it weeks or months later. But on that Friday, before that Sunday, that check came. And guys, we were able to triple what we had decided we should do. God provides. There are just so many stories that can be given and talked about, but God does it. John Medder was talking about First Baptist Euless several years ago. They had a rough experience with a pastor, and that pastor had left. And when he left, they had built all these massive buildings, and they were $7 million in debt. And an interim, who I was able to visit with the other day, Bill Anderson, still doing interim work. Bill used to pastor there, and Bill led them to get rid of that debt. $7 million. Now, First Euless is a big church, and they've got some deep pockets, but let me tell you, $7 million in 28 months was gone, and they were debt-free. He said, guys, there is no way, looking at our church, there's no way that could have happened other than God doing something that only God could do and doing it through his people. He said, out of that came tons and tons of testimonies of how God did things. One lady, a single mother, said she had been praying before anything was announced. She had been praying and God told her to double her tithes. And she said, it didn't make a bit of sense to me, but I did it. And she said, when I came to church the next Sunday, there was an idea that lets for 1 month everyone double their tithes. And she said, what a confirmation. God had told me that at home this week, and then I get to church, and now the whole church is doing it. God said, this is right. And she said, I've never stopped because I saw God's provision. Now you say, well, Pastor, is it going to work that way every time? No. No. I can tell you of other times that we've tithed and we've wondered where supper was coming from, mainly at seminary. But we saw God provide, sometimes not in exorbitant ways, but in ways that we never dreamed. Just enough, sometimes in abundance, but he blesses because he wants to provide. I wish I had time to tell you some stories. Judy was telling me about Jeremy and Megan, and they were coming from Oregon and driving through, and God had a hedge of protection around that vehicle that it should have never made it here because of a wheel problem. But when they got it to the mechanic here, he said, I can't believe you even survived the trip. God provides. Fourthly, God wants us to experience his protection. Malachi 3:11. I will rebuke the devourer for you so that it will not ruin the produce of your land and your vine in your field will not fail to produce fruit. This last year, my son, of course, many of you know, he has bought 10.5 acres down in Grandview. The front acreage of it is just beautiful open land. And he had been mowing it and it looked so good. One day he got out to run his mower across it and he looked down, there was some dead spots. And he started investigating. What he found was some little caterpillar-like worms that was literally eating the grass. And within a matter of days, that entire front property was totally gone of grass. The devourer. The Bible tells us there's a devourer. The Bible calls him Satan. Jesus talks about him like this in John 10:10. A thief comes only to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come so that they may have life and have it in abundance. And that abundance is not just in the life to come, but it's in this life. Satan will, Satan can, Satan does declare war on your finances. He does. He is the devourer. We need God's protection in our finances. Deuteronomy 29:5. I led you 40 years in the wilderness. Your clothes and your sandals on your feet did not wear out. I think that's cool. Now, I'm not sure my wife does. Can you imagine her going 40 years with the same pair of shoes? You can't, and I can't, and she can't. But I think it's cool. I will preserve the shoes on your feet. I will preserve the clothing on your back for 40 years. There were no Walmarts in that process. And what they had, God protected for the entire journey, even though the journey was that long because of their disobedience. What a God. So God wants us to experience His presence. He wants us to experience His balance. He wants us to experience His faithfulness. And He wants us to experience His protection. God wants all that for you. Bet you never heard Malachi 3 from that angle. That's what He wants for you. But we have to get to the question of what does God ask from you? This is what God wants for you, but what does God ask from you? We've read it multiple times. Bring all the tithe into the storehouse. That's to say that He wants us to acknowledge Him as our God and to worship and honor Him in our giving. We need to get to the place where we understand when we bring tithes and offerings into the storehouse, we're not giving to the preacher. We're really not even giving to the church. We're giving to God through the church. Big difference. A manner of worship and honor. And here, please understand, I'm not trying to be hard, but here's the deal. Incomplete worship is not really worship. To say that I worship in this area and this area and this area of my life, but I don't worship in this area, that's incomplete worship. God wants us to acknowledge that He is Lord of all, everything we have, everything we are. All that is from Him, and we are to worship Him in acknowledging that. You say, but I work hard for the money I make. Absolutely you do. But if it wasn't for God, you wouldn't have the strength to lift up one hand and put the foot in front of the other. He gives you your health. Yeah, but I went to school to learn how to do all this. Absolutely you did. But He's the one that gave you the brain that could process that stuff. Yeah, but I don't get my money from God. I get my money from my employer. If it wasn't for God, that employer wouldn't be making profits to be able to give you money. Listen, it's more than capitalism, okay? And I believe in it. But it's more than that. It is God's provision. The Bible says He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. And it's that picture that He owns it all. And the way he distributes it and the way it comes to us is still his provision. You say, but my employer is not a very godly person, so how? Listen, God works through the ungodly to bring about godly things. I've heard people say, well, you got to be, God said he had certain people and he ordained them or he anointed them to do certain things. Well, you can look at Bible and find in the Old Testament, especially where he anointed evil nations to bring about what he was trying to do for his people to return to him. So God will use anything and everything he wants to bring provision. So we've got to come to the place where we understand God owns it all. And we wouldn't have anything. Listen, it's God's blessing in your life that you were born in the United States of America. You could have been born in North Korea. Think about it. We're to worship him with our tithes and offerings. Tithes, by definition, is a tenth. That's just what the word means. Offerings is anything over and above the tenth. When we look at the word storehouse, it's talking about in Malachi, it's talking about the temple. And the equivalent of that in the New Testament is the church, the local church. And so it is teaching, as we move it into the New Testament time, it is teaching to bring a tenth, a tithe, of your income into the local church. And then he still talks about offerings that go beyond that. You say, so let me get this right, Pastor. If I bring a tenth and I write a check and I give a tenth of my income, then I can do anything I want to with the rest of it? Well, you can, but I wouldn't advise it. See, God gives us stewardship over it all. And so to be a good steward means we need to use wisdom. And there are times that I need to say no to myself. And I need to say no to my children. I need to say wait to myself. I need to say wait. It's a good thing to have to wait for some things. It makes you appreciate it a whole lot more. And so with the 90% that's left, God wants us and expects us to be good, wise stewards of that. So he doesn't just say, okay, go have a party with the rest of it. But he says there's 10% of that that's mine. Great biblical principle, Proverbs 3, 9 through 10. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first produce of your entire harvest. Then your barns will be completely filled and your vats will overflow with new wine. Jesus gives advice in Matthew chapter 6, verse 20. But collect for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves don't break in and steal. So many of the things that we focus on is going to be gone and burned up when this earth ends. Investment into the kingdom of God is for all eternity. Why on earth would we soak so much of what we have and what God has blessed us with into things that are going to just be destroyed? Paul says in 1 Corinthians 16, 1 and 2, talking to the church at Corinth, he says, now about the collection for the saints, you should do the same as I instructed the church of Galatia. On the first day of the week, which would be Sunday, each of you is to set something aside and save in keeping with how he prospers. So this is where we see the tithe is based on the income as you increase. So 10% of your income is for God. He says, do it on the first day of the week. That's the day we gather to worship. You say, well, I don't get paid every Friday. I understand that. I don't either. We've got the same principle. What we do is I get paid twice a month, and on that that Sunday right after that, as a matter of fact, I never see mine. It's automatic draft right into the church's account. But as I get paid, tithe comes out. Now, Guys, I really, it doesn't matter to me. Some people say, I still want to take that envelope. Had that discussion the other day. I still believe I want to take that envelope and I want to put it in. Praise God. Some say, I want to put it in Sunday school. Great. Others say, I want to put it in the plate when it's passed. Wonderful. Some of us say, I can't remember to bring a check with me if I don't come up with something else, so the automatic draft works great for us. It doesn't matter. What does matter is the first 10% belongs to God, and that's what He asked from us. You say, well, that's Old Testament, not New Testament. Well, it's the only percentage really given in the Bible. And here's what I've found. If we'll learn to be faithful with that, generosity will just roll. It is amazing what God will do in our lives. See, I was taught this as a child. Now, we didn't get an allowance. Four of us boys, we never got a dime of allowance. My dad said, you eat here and you need to produce something here. Okay? But you know what? When I was a kid, we got birthday money. Lose a tooth, you get a little money there. You know what I mean? You've got money coming in a little bit. But we were taught when you got that dollar, 10 cents of it is God's. And you put that in that offering, in that envelope, and you put your name on it, and you turn that in, and we did. We taught our children that. And by the way, I did finally get to where I was mowing yards. And every time I mowed a yard, whatever I got paid, I was taught that 10% of that goes to God, and a percentage of it goes to savings and all that stuff. But it became a way of life for me. I didn't know anybody else did it any other way. And we taught our children those principles. And I'm excited that both of our children in their lives now, if their husband and their wife, they're actively involved in doing what God asked them to do with their finances in their churches. And they're teaching their children. You see what happens? Neat story the other day, and Steve, I hope you don't mind. If you do, I know you well enough to know you'll get over it. But Grace had gotten some money for birthday and so forth, and she had pulled her 10% out, and she had an envelope, and they forgot to bring it to church. And he said his first reaction was, oh, you can do it next week. And then he thought, wait a minute, I'm trying to teach a principle here. And they slipped out and went home, and if Amber hadn't hit it, they would have brought it back. So they did get it the next week. But the principle was teaching our children what tithing is. Listen, if you learn it with that little bit of money you get as a child, your income just kind of grows and you just keep moving with it, and it's really not that hard. The bottom line is that God wants more for us than He wants from us. So I want to give you an illustration this morning. Again, this is not original with me, but when I saw it, I thought it was probably one of the most vivid illustrations I'd ever seen. I found the only thing I could find to cover this up with. So you see the devourers, the ants. That wasn't intended. It just happened that way. But I want you to think about what God gives us. And I'll do it with fruit. To make it easy to do the math, because I am challenged in some areas. 10 bananas. God just keeps providing. Every time I turn around, and you know how it is, when you work, you get paid, money comes in, you produce, and as you produce, there's the income you have, the increase you have. Some of these little, why'd you buy those little pears? Because I don't like soft pears. I have to eat mine green right off the tree. So I know who's going to have to eat these when it's over. Some clementines. We have those here. 10 of each of these makes it a lot easier for us to work with. And Jerry said, can you keep them all on that table? We're going to find out. Some apples. 4 different kinds of fruit representing how God has blessed and what God is giving me through and you through our ability to earn an income and have the skills and the talents to do that. So here's God providing for us. As we look at that, we say, well, it's not a bad looking stack there. God's provision in our lives. What does God ask from you? 1/10 of the bananas, 1/10 of the pears, 1 apple, 1 clementine. From this angle, it doesn't look like much. I hear people say, man, 10% is so much. But from what I see, it's really not. Some of you are going, well, yeah, but you're the preacher. You're looking at it from the pastor's standpoint. You're looking at it from your side of the pulpit. Well, I got news for you. I'm getting close to being 50-50 from the time of my salvation to being called in ministry. But I actually spent more time on this side of the pulpit down here with you than I did up there on that side of the pulpit. Guess what? It looks the same from here as it does from up there. There's still an enormous amount of what God is leaving for us, and He says, this is yours. This is mine. This represents our tithe. 10% of all that God gives us is an increase. You say, well, that's great, but there's always those things that come up. You know, there's those kids that want to go to camp or want to go on a mission trip, and I feel so compelled to help them with that. So keep your hands off of what's God's. He's left you with this huge pile. So here, we've got a student that's going on a mission trip, and so I can take from my stack... How did I know he was the one that wanted that? And I can give it to someone. And look, we're furthering the kingdom of God. It's ministry. It's going beyond ministry of my tithing. It's going to help someone go on a mission trip or go to camp. Well, you know, I looked around and trying to decide what I want to take home with me. But I look around and there's the Lottie Moon Christmas offering coming up. And I want to take part in that. So what do? I give, but I give out of mine, not out of God's. And we can keep coming up with all those things, and there are tremendous ministries. Jerry and I have always seemed to have had some ministry that outside the church that we're supporting. People are always asking. We have special offerings from the church, and we're asked to give for those things. And sometimes, you know, it's not always the kids that want that. Sometimes it's an adult. And we're helping them. But all the time we do that, we take from the 90% that God has left us with. And when I start looking at it, I've still got a huge amount. So don't tell me 10% is so huge. It's really not. For every dollar, we're talking about a dime. And when I think of the things I spend money on? You know, it's just me, but McDonald's coffee is just as good as Starbucks coffee. Unless it's been sitting there all day. I need to think. Think about how much we spend, and I'm not saying we shouldn't do this, but think about what we spend in baseball, football, basketball, dance, gymnastics, and we just keep naming. Oh, we can't afford to tithe. But boy, we do all that other stuff. And God says when we use what's His to do those other things, I'm not saying this, God says this, He says you're robbing me. So here's what I want us to get. Tithing is all about walking with God in our finances. Listen, we're sitting today in a church that's been here 127 years, roughly. There were people that tithed and gave so that we could be sitting in a building that's debt-free. For 127 years, people have been giving so that we can enjoy doing ministry today. Are we going to be the generation that stops it? Or are we going to be the generation that continues that history? That continues to provide so that the next generation can do ministry? And so that they teach the next generation to do ministry? Folks, it's not just about, it's about a world that needs to know Christ. It's about people that need the Lord. It's about the people that will be in this community in the years ahead that will need to know the Lord. There are ministries that have come and gone, and I was struggling for an illustration this morning of just something to grab a hold of, and I got it just before the service started. Here's a lady sitting right here. I came in and she said, I came to this church in the bus ministry this church had years ago. Mike Leith driving the bus. She said, I'm going to sit up there on the fourth row where I used to sit, and that's where I set my church in Atlanta now. Listen, we don't have any idea the far-reaching effects of the ministry that God gives us. Mark Estep and his brother Wendell came through this church. A few months ago, I went out with them, and they stood on the steps of the old building, and I took their picture with a wife and a cousin as they were saying, this is the church that we came to faith in Christ in. They're both in ministry, one in North Carolina and the other in Spring, Texas. This church, through the tithes and offerings of God's people, still affecting people today. Mark not only is down there, I know more about him than I do Wendell. Wendell and his wife were asked and I didn't know this till I saw it on Facebook, to speak. John Bassanio, the longtime pastor at First Baptist Houston's wife, passed away. He lost his house and all of his possessions in the flood. And then weeks later, his wife died. But Wendell and his wife were able to speak and give testimony about Miss Bassanio. Mark is in Spring, Texas, Spring Baptist Church. Their church, I think, had some damage, but they have become one of the centers for reaching out and helping people in Houston. Because Mark came to faith because of the faithfulness of people in this church. In many ways, including tithes and offerings, he's making an impact for the kingdom of God in Houston. Have you read the articles about the Southern Baptist Convention disaster relief? I mean, they're saying the Southern Baptist disaster relief teams are responding faster than the Red Cross and the Salvation Army or anybody else. There was a great article about this massive, and I forgot how many thousands of people responding and helping as the church. Churches, local churches together. But it couldn't be done without the tithes and the offerings of God's people. So this morning, I'm going to challenge you to test God. Now, I had a former pastor that did that one time, and what he made the statement that you can't outgive God. And there was a lady that gave a large amount of money, and then her heirs ended up suing the church and him because she gave $10,000 and she didn't get $10,000 plus back. If that's what you think I'm saying, you're missing the whole point. God sometimes will bless us in finances, but he blesses us in so many other ways. Test God and see if he won't open up the doors of heaven and shower blessings upon you, as he uses you to do something more than you could ever do yourself. God's economy is so much better than ours. Will you take that challenge? If you're here this morning and you don't know Christ as your personal Savior, the first thing you need to do is come to faith in Christ, to have that personal relationship with Him, and then learn that obedience. If you're not a member of this church, I'm not asking you to give anything, because we believe that God's temple, God's church, the local church, ought to be funded by the people in that local church. And the beauty of the tenth is it's just as easy and it's just as hard, no matter how much you make, because it's proportional giving. And Sam, I'll say it for you. It's all God's, because He'll challenge me every time. It's all God's, and sometimes He tells us to do more than 10%. And if you don't do what He says, it's sin then too, guys. But will you join with me committing to that? And let's see what God will do through our obedience to Him. This is what He gives. This is what He wants for us. This is what He asks from us.